So I'm just curious because I think Dale's going to win. But what do you have to eat for good luck in the new year? What? Hoppin' John, all right. Sauerkraut? Really? I am not sure how sour, because it's so crappy the year's going to get better or something. All right. What? What's somebody else? What? Pierogies? All right, I'm set. What? Black-eyed peas? That's right. Cornbread, collard greens. Now we're talking, people. Now we're in the real stuff. Okay, Dale eats is herring. Oh, y'all know that too? Y'all are some weird people, man. I'm not sure how pickled herring brings about good luck, but what? Barbecue. Yeah, well, that's every day. All right, so we're doing this kind of in between thing, and 2017, it is over, yay, in lots of ways. 2017 is over. The good, the bad, and the ugly, it's all gone. We're great with it. Thanks for playing. Bye. Here's what I'd love for you to do, though. Turn to a few people right now, and you're just kind of an, oh, I don't want to be with people. But just somebody you like, okay? Just turn to one or two people and just say, hey, what I am going to remember about 2017 is. Ready? Go. All right, shouldn't take that long. Let me hear a few of them. What are some things you're gonna remember about? All right, and graduating from college. Well done. That's something to remember from 2017. Anybody else? What? Our daughter got a promotion at work. Nobody else remembers anything about 2017. Yeah, way up in the balcony. What? Yeah, the hurricane. That was a good week of our life. Pam? What? Went to the Virgin Islands before they were destroyed. Please don't say Bob's the reason they got destroyed, but that's okay. Anybody else? New job? New grandchild? Nobody remembers the Seabreeze soccer championship? I mean, you should. Come on, people. Come on. State championship, none of y'all? Oh, a baby was born? That's rememberable. Experience. Oh, that gets the all moment, right? I mean, 2017, there were some good moments, and we it's always interesting. We always seem to focus on the bad stuff a lot of times. There really were a lot of good moments, but there are some moments, and I call them the good, the bad, and the ugly. I don't care. It's over. And you ain't got to go back to it. But when you, it's that time of year where they've been showing all those Christmas movies, and I love Scrooge, not Christmas Carol, but Scrooged. With Bill Murray. It's one of my favorites of all time. And wouldn't you love that opportunity of the Christmas Carol of Scrooge, just the ability to make a fresh start all over. Wouldn't that be great? And that's what all the Christmas movies are about. And then I realized they're all lying. Scrooge does not get to start over. He just wakes up from a dream. He cannot fix the past. We have this idea that, okay, he goes, he has this dream, and he, you know, or this, and he wakes up and everything's going to be wonderful. No, it's not. He's still a mean person with all that stuff. You can't just wipe away 2017 as though it didn't exist. You do not get to start with a clean slate. That's what we talk about, that we get to start with a clean slate in 2017. Really? Wait till January and that credit card bill shows up. They don't start over. They don't give you a clean slate because, I mean, you don't get that. What you can do, though, is like Scrooge wakes up and he realizes, I cannot change the past, but I can change me now, and I can move forward. and I can change the future. That's what I love. There are all kinds of scripture passages that we can preach on this time of year. So I try to find one we don't normally preach on, maybe to expose y'all to some other passages of scripture. And this is from Isaiah. I've been reading a lot in the prophets recently. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. Some of y'all right now need to memorize that verse. I'm just letting you know, your life in 2018 is going to be significantly better if you will forget the former things. Do not dwell on. That's what I'm saying. Just let it go. Right? See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. And that is a theme of faith, and what we believe is the old has gone, the new has come. We can leave what was, and we can move to what can be. That our faith, what it teaches us and what we follow about Jesus Christ is that who we were is not who we have to be. We can change, we can grow, we can move, we can mature, but there are some things that we have to do on that. And so I kind of wrote them out. We're doing a thing called the ABCs of Financial Freedom next week, but I came up with these ABCs for the new year. The first one is this. And I said assume. I'm probably going to say, I'd probably change it now. I'm thinking about it in my head. I'd say accept responsibility for your life. Okay, just quit blaming other people. Quit whining. Quit saying it's not my fault, it's your fault. As my soccer terminology, suck it up. We've been playing a lot of games in my house because that's what my wife likes to do when all the children are home. It doesn't go well. We are the most competitive family in the history of the world, perhaps. We play this one game that she loves. I can't remember the name of it, but it's a bunch of trains, and you have to build your trains. Anybody know that game? You build your trains around the nation. What's it called? Good, great. Thanks for knowing it. I'm preaching it. I can't remember the name of it. But it is sheer luck of the draw. There is no skill in this. It's all about which cards you get. And that's why I like to keep the cards and shuffle them. Few your way if you need to, right? But I was thinking about that. We all get dealt cards. You can't control the cards you're dealt. You can control how you play them. It's easy to talk about it in a game, but in life, you can't fix or choose your circumstances. You can't control what's going to happen to you. I can't control what's going to happen in Ormond Beach or the nation or this church or I can't control what's going to happen to me. But I can control how I respond to my circumstances, no matter what they are. And to accept the responsibility that I can't control which cards I get dealt, but how I play them, I can assume that responsibility. I can accept that responsibility. Making the most out of the new year, leaving the past is quit dwelling on it. And to accept the responsibility that, well, you know, this is it. We're laughing with Caleb was home this week. My son, he's teaching school now, and he's been complaining about his students who don't turn in their homework. I went, huh. Shocking how that goes. I said, you don't remember telling me why you were getting such a bad grade in Algebra 2 when you were in the sophomore, and I went to the teacher because the teacher was a horrible person. I went to set up a meeting, and I go to the teacher, and the teacher says, well, he's not turning in his homework. And you told me, well, she doesn't ask, and I'm getting on to her about that, and she points to the box that says homework. And she says they're just supposed to drop it off every day when they walk in. He doesn't remember that. He has his choice. Assume the responsibility. We always want to blame everybody else. You can't control what's going to happen to you, but you can control how you respond. That's going to be my goal this year, just something you can hold me accountable. I can't control those people that drive on Granada. But it sure does irritate me. One of the things I've learned that my phone automatically hooks into my radio thingy, and I'm playing a podcast, and when I get in that car, that podcast is automatically going to come on. It's on World War I, fascinating right now, but I'm just going to listen to that, because I can't control them drivers on Granada, but I can control how I respond to them, and I can control how it makes me feel when I get to church, or when I get to the restaurant, or that. And so y'all can hold me accountable. That's just one little thing. I can't control how they're going to drive. I can't control how I respond to it. Assume or accept responsibility. Believe you can change. That's the B of the ABCs. Believe you can change. Because you can. You can change. That's our faith. It tells us that we don't have to be who we were. We can be new. The old has gone, the new has come. Believe that. It's why you show up every week, because there's this belief within you that things can be different. It can change. It takes time. That's the C part of the word that we don't like. Commit to it. I read this week that 41% of Americans make New Year's resolutions. Obviously, they haven't talked to my mom, who believes that's a ritual you're supposed to do every year. Only 9% keep them. 9% of everybody who makes a New Year's resolution keeps it. If you read the comics today, for better or for worse, they go around doing their New Year's resolution, and the kid says, I'm going to play street hockey more and eat all I want. And everybody else says, we're talking about being, he goes, I'm going to keep my resolutions. Right? Commit to it, to work on it, to pursue it, to press on. That person that you feel like God's calling you to be, do it. We want it like that. It doesn't happen. I'm a different person than I am today than I was 20 years ago. I was thinking about it as we were singing the song. I preach pretty much every Sunday after Christmas my entire life. Because when I was a youth director, that's what youth directors preach. When I was an associate, that's when associates preach. Now I just like preaching, so I got nothing better to do with my life. So I show up, right? I'm a better preacher than I was 20 years ago. Be thankful. Right? I'm a better person than I was 20 years ago. My wife will tell you that. Am I where I need to be? Mm-mm. Do I have my moments? Oh, sure. I still let my temper get to me. I still let anger get to me. I still let pride get to me, but I'm better. I still let competition get to me, but I don't cheat as much with my children as I used to. You can change. It's slow steps. But it starts with this commitment to change. Joshua writes about it this way in this famous passage we know. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods of your ancestors, worship beyond the Euphrates River in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable for you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve. It's a great passage. Joshua's laying out, look, you got to make a choice. Choose to serve God or choose not to. I don't care, but pick one. Don't halfway do it. Don't say you're going to choose one. Whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites whose land you are living. But as for me, this is what we all know. This is the one most of y'all probably have. All right, be honest. Raise your hands. How many of y'all have this somewhere in your house? A lot of you. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We forget all the other stuff. Joshua's been lining it up. Which one are you going to do? Which one are you going to serve? You going to choose God or you going to choose whatever else? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our parents out of Egypt, that land of slavery, and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on the entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. Right? And we're going to serve God because we know what God's going to do for us. This is who we are. Here's what I'm going to ask you to commit to this year. One, these are all, you've been here before, you know them. We're going to expect you to show up at worship. I know that's strange on the lowest Sunday of the year that I'm telling the people who are here on the lowest Sunday of the year, hey, show up. That's, you know, it's sort of like, duh, right? The world's changing. Worship doesn't mean what it used to for folks. I was telling Liz and Ken this morning that a bunch of the articles come out this time of year on Preacher World, you know, the top 10 posts of Church World kind of thing, and I was reading them. Most of them are all about church attendance and the declining of church attendance, not just across the board, all churches, and especially the move right now with a mega church that these large, massive churches are beginning to realize, we don't know if we can keep sustaining this. What do we do? How do we figure it out? We had 5 services last week, right? 2 for Christmas Eve, Sunday morning, 3 for Christmas Eve, Sunday night. We'll come to one of them. And it happens here all the time. We do blessings of the animals or Sunday morning. Which one are you going to come to? One of them, right? And I get that. Part of me wants to go, I can rail against this. Or maybe I begin to realize, how does worship need to change? Because here's what's key about worship. Worship is that place where we gather together as a community to deepen our faith in some way, to connect with God in some way. Tammy, are you here? I don't like all the songs we sing. She's a really phenomenal singer. I just don't like singing. I mean, I do, but... And there's some of y'all going, I don't like the preaching. I love the sound of my voice over and over and over again. And there's some of y'all going, we don't read the Bible. You ain't never opened up a Bible in this church, Scott Smith. I'm like, I read it off the screen every day. You ain't opened up a Bible. Got to read from the Bible. And there's some of you going, we don't pray enough. We got some going, we ain't got enough. We don't do communion right. Well, I mean, what I love about worship is I love the fact that we sing songs I don't like because there are words in those songs that I don't like that I'm like, wow. And there are melodies that touch my soul that if I never would have sung that song, I never would have heard it. And there are times where we should sing more than we preach. And there are times we should preach more than we sing. And there are times we should just say, hey, today, open up your Bibles to Mark. We're just going to read that whole chapter, that whole book. It's going to take us about 30 minutes. Lighten up, people. Right? And we will never, and I'll go on record here, we will never say on a Sunday morning, we're going to open up Leviticus and we're going to read all of Leviticus today. There are probably some Sundays we should just say, you know what, instead of a sermon today, we're just going to pray. We got into our ritual and our routine, and what I love about worship is y'all. There's something about y'all and how you sing and how you pray and how you interpret the scriptures and how you see God at work that helps me take the next step on my journey of faith. It's why we've got to gather together to worship in some way. Does it always have to be on a Sunday morning at 9 o'clock? Or is there another way to do it? I don't know. We'll work through that. But we have to gather together. That's what I'm going to ask you to commit to do. Is this year is to gather together to worship, to realize that faith is not about what you think. It's not about what you believe. Faith's a we thing. We've messed up in the U.S. by making the Bible all about me and worship all about what I want. It's a group. It's why we can sit in this room and we got some good old Democrats in here. Thank you, Jesus. We got some Republicans too. Thank you, Jesus. Right? That we can be in this place and we can have folks who believe we're headed in the right direction, and folks believe we're headed in the wrong direction in Volusia County, and yet, thank you, Jesus. It's because we begin to realize that when we gather together and worship, we're one with God and one with each other and one in ministry to the world. It's why we got to gather together. So I'm going to ask you to commit to do that this year. And I'm also going to ask you to do one other thing with worship. There's corporate worship. There's also individual worship. My prayer life and your prayer life, well, I'll pick on Alan. Because I know Alan's prayer life and my prayer life, he does it at night. He likes to read and be quiet at night. At 9 o'clock at night, there is nothing better on than sleep. I'm just not a night, but I'm an early morning kind of guy. Whatever works for you, works for you. Some of y'all need to read your Bible. Others of you need to read somebody else reading your Bible to help you. I don't. Some type of personal daily ritual where you stop what you're doing and you say, God, I honor you. Now, I think you need to read a little bit of the Bible and pray in that moment. But if you want to debate that, fine. But and I think you should memorize a little bit of Scripture, but... because it comes back later on in life when you're driving on Granada to help you in ways. So worship. I expect you to serve. I'm really excited. January 14th, we're kicking off the Habitat House. That'll be great. We're going to start all the construction project on the Habitat House. But to serve in some capacity, because if you don't serve, you know what you are? Fat Christian. You're just somebody who sucks it all in and doesn't give it out. And it's that time of year we're going to start working out, trying to get healthier again. But if you're a Christian and all you do is come in on Sunday morning and take, that ain't good for nobody. You got to serve in some way. And serve in whatever way you want to. Picking on Rob. Rob Bentley does a phenomenal job as church treasurer. He loves numbers. Both he and Brett have realized when you give a lot of numbers to Scott, watch the eyes glaze over and freak out, right? I'm just like, oh my God, more numbers. Put me in a room full of teenagers, let's go, baby. We got stuff to do, right? Find where you're gifted in at. Find out where your strengths are and use them there. But serve in some capacity this year. Because what will happen, what I've learned, when you serve, you actually grow in your faith. You think it's all about, well, I've gotten all this in, so I got to get it all out. No, it's you gotten all this in, so you give it all out. And what you discover is you're giving it all out, you actually grow more. Cameron, are you up there? Hey, hon, how you doing? Wave at me. Ask me the best question today. What was your question? Is heaven past space? That's the question I got asked on the way into church today. What'd you get asked? That question will cause you to stop to think, won't it? All of a sudden I have to start talking to a sixth grader about where is heaven. My faith grows a little bit in that moment when you stop to do things like that. Want you to worship, want you to serve. Guess what the third one is? Give. There ain't no better way to say it. Pony up your cash. What you do with your money matters, and it makes a difference. I love how this church gives to projects, how we give to Children's Home, how we give to New Start, how we give to Great Kids, how we give to Habitat. But how do we faithfully give every week to God, putting God first in our finances? We'll talk to you more about this next month, but what I'd love for you to do this year is just figure out, what do you give? Figure out what you give, and we'll help you figure out how to do it. Figure out what you give, and your goal this year, 1% more. 1% more. That's it. We're not asking for you to, you know, give $8.7 million. We're not asking you to turn in your tax return stuff. We're just saying, look, be intentional. If you gave this amount next year, give 1% more. And not just give more with your finances, but your most precious resource, your time. And God gets your time. I find it interesting when it comes to church stuff. I watch y'all. All of a sudden, church gets to 10 o'clock. 10:05. Mm-hmm. 10:15. All right? We over at that point. That football game go 20 minutes longer. That was the best thing ever. As long as your team wins, right? Your time is your most precious resource, so schedule it out. All right, every Sunday I'm going to be in worship, or Thursday I'm going to worship, or every morning I'm going to read my Bible at this time, and I'm going to give my time in serving here. And then we want you to share your faith in some way. I don't need you to go out there evangelizing to people. I don't need you to go, hey, you need to give your life to Jesus, you're going to burn. That's not who we are. Right? But I do think it's important for you to talk about your faith. I think it's important for you to be honest about your faith. And I think one of the biggest things that we have failed to do is we have failed to tell people it's okay to struggle and not know. Some of y'all get really frustrated with me because you'll come ask me a question. I'm like, I don't know. What do you think? How do you... That's something I'm wrestling with. Jennifer and I emailed this week. I'm like, I don't know. I'm trying to figure that out on my own. I'm trying to figure it out as well. Trying to ask questions on it. I think that's sharing your faith when you're up front. When somebody says, hey, what do you think about this? I don't know, my faith, one of the things I'm really wrestling with, one of the things I really struggle with. Well, how did you do this? Because share your faith. Be honest about it. Talk to your neighbors about it. Saw my neighbor this morning. I was backing out of the truck. He's like, where are you going? I'm like, really? It's like, I'm going to church. Oh, that's right. See you tonight. Even though we've invited them 90 times. Right? Right? But share it. You have to assume the responsibility for your life. Yeah, I can't control the cards that are dealt to you, but you can control how you play them. You got to believe you can change, because you can. And it all starts with a choice and a commitment. John Wesley, as he turned the year every year, he wrote a prayer out called his covenant prayer. And I share this with you. This is the modern version. Wesley lived in a time where King James English was the verbiage of the day. We don't speak King James anymore. So there's some folks that have modernized it. But this is a great prayer for us to think about. As we begin to think about those things I'm asking you to do and us to, I'm not just asking you to do them. I'm going to do them all. But as we begin to think about moving into 2018, what if this was the way we lived the year out? I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing, really like that one. Put me to suffering. Although I've read a book this week that told me our greatest triumphs in life come through our sufferings. I don't want to suffer, God. But if I got to go through suffering, may it make me stronger. Let me be employed for you, yes, or laid aside for you, which means lose my job for you. Be exalted for you or brought low for you. Let me be full, let me be empty, let me have all things, let me have nothing. I love how Wesley's doing it. Here, let me have whatever happens, whatever cards I'm dealt. Whether I got a job or I'm hungry, whether everything's going wonderful or I'm suffering miserably, I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and your disposal. And now, glorious and blessed Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. And let the covenant in me made on earth now be ratified in heaven. May that be your prayer for this year. God, no matter what happens to me, I guess if I were to be Scott Smith language for Wesley, Wesley's a lot smarter than me. Hey, no matter what the cards are dealt to you, whether you got all aces or a two, a seven, a king, and a queen, no matter what's been dealt to you, God, let me play these cards out that you gave me for your glory. Let me assume responsibility. I believe I can change. I'm committed to it. As you come forward for communion today, God was with you in 2017, in the good, in the bad, and in the ugly. And God will be with you in 2018. Because on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks unto God, and broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. And this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took a cup. He gave thanks unto God. After giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you should drink of it in remembrance of me." And so today, come in remembrance of all that God has done for you in 2017. All those moments this year where you knew God was with you, where you felt God's presence, even those moments that were dark, even those moments of suffering, that God's hand was with you. Come forward today going, "God, thank you." And then maybe in this moment as you're receiving communion, you can hear God's love and grace being shared with you. Say, "I'm going to go with you in 2018. And when you turn and walk back to your seats, or after you finish praying and you walk back to your seats, may you think like Scrooge. I can't change what happened back then. But from this moment forward, things can be different." Let's pray. God, we just ask that you pour out your spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of the bread and the cup, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ. That as we feast on them, we might experience your love and your grace. And we give you thanks for 2017, for all those moments we experienced your light in the midst of the darkness. The good moments, God, where we celebrated in triumph with you. And then the dark moments, God, when the only way we made it through is because your hand pulled us. You pulled us out of that miry pit. God, as we move into 2018, may we grab a hold of that hand and not let go. May we raise it in moments of victory and triumph, and in moments of darkness and despair, drag us through to the light of eternity. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.